here I go. Hello and welcome to my very first podcast ever. My name is Karen. I go by Carota. I answer to either one. Karen is the name my mama gave me. Carota is the name I gave myself. This is a podcast about crocheting. I've been crocheting since 2014, so I don't consider myself advanced in any way. I am still a pretty seasoned beginner, but I wanted to start this podcast about crocheting because for months I have been watching, I came to YouTube to watch, when I first started crocheting in 14, to learn techniques and to enhance my techniques. And many months ago, I discovered that not only were there great technique instructional videos on YouTube, but there are also these podcasts by yarn heads discussing what they do. And I really like that. And it's sort of like a little social community, but through video. And this is so out of character for me. I would much prefer to observe quietly somewhere in the background or write before I would speak. So here I am speaking in front of a camera at that. So we'll see how this goes. It is a learning process for me. Just to get to this point that you see now, has taken months. Really, it has taken, well, maybe not months, weeks. I've been practicing since probably the 1st of August doing this and talking into a camera, which is a little strange. And so there I am, and here I am, gonna join you. Not only will you see crochet, but you will also see me learning to knit, which I'm getting ready to start. And also, I'm a mixed media art quilter, so you will see some of that as well. Not much, but some. And you will also see what I call my dabbling or piddling, which I named it Carota University School of Art. It's all the little things I do to kind of support my creative life. And I'll talk more about that in a minute. I'm going to show you what that is and what that kind of looks like a little bit. I am married with three adult children, three school-age children. We are a multi-generational household. So from time to time, you might see, especially my grandkids, photobombing my podcast, but that's cool with me. So that's who I am. My first calling as a creative was that of a poet, though. And I've been writing poetry most of my adult life, from a teenager to most of my adult life. And I guess about late 90s, I lost what I call my poet's ear. And, excuse me, I lost my poet's ear, and but reemerged when my health became stable as a visual artist, and that's where the mixed media art quilting comes in. And since 2014, I've been crocheting like a mad woman. I haven't created many quilts in that time, but it's time. So I'm going to be doing both, kind of jump starting my quilting as well. And so you'll see a little bit of that. Some of the segments that I know that I'll be doing are called Off the Hook, which are finished objects, finished pieces that I've had for the month. Off the Hook, Works in Progress are going to be called On the Hook, or On the Needles, I guess, Off the Needles if I add knitting. And then the Carota University School of Art will be a segment, and Stash Enhancements, which are the things that I've acquired during that month, that new yarns, new hooks, new whatever that are related to the craft, I'll be sharing with you. And also, what else? Stash Enhancements, off the hook, on the hooks, I'm reading from my notes, Kuroda University School of Art, and a little bit every now and then of the mixed media. But the other things are going to be your staples of this podcast. And if there's something that you'd like to see, just kind of let me know as we go along. I'm learning, I'm developing this, so I'm open to suggestions for improvement, so feel free. Excuse me again. Let me go ahead and get started, won't I? Okay. For one, I'm going to take a drink of my tea here. And I'm going to start with things that are on the hooks. Okay. I am making a shawl for myself. It's called the Pacific Rim Shawl. The pattern is called Pacific Rim Shawl. And it is, the pattern is made by Esther Chandler. And you can find these on Ravelry. And I'll also leave all my social media info. It would be the last thing that you see that'll at the end of the podcast. But this shawl is my first striped work. I'm using two yarns to make it. And it is made, the yarn that I'm using, the reddish bluish yarn. It's probably best held, you can probably see it best from the back here as opposed to close up, I think. The reddish bluish yarn is, it's called, it's by Jojo Land, and it's called Melody. And it is 100% wool, superwash wool. And so that's it. And then the other is a Malabrigo yarn, the brown, the gold, brownish mustard colored, is by Malabrigo. And it is, I don't know. I think it is silk and wool, merino wool, I believe. But that's the brown. And like I said, it's my first time using striped wool. I am about a third of the way finished. It's very dense pattern. I'm using single stitch. And what I love about it are these, in addition to the stripes, it has these five little points where the stitch markers are the points. You can see, and that's the pattern, it will be the edge. And it's five of them. And I really like this pattern. I know I'm going to make it in another colorway. But I started this, back in, when did I start this? It's been a while. I want to say March. I am a very slow crocheter. Very slow. So, and I always have at least 3 to 4 projects going. So, I just tend to work steady. I crochet every day, even if it's just 15 minutes. And this, what else I have on the hips, my next project, I've been wanting to get into making clothes. And you have to acquire a lot of yarn to make sweaters, cardigans, skirts, whatever. And especially if you are a person of substance. So, I decided to start with my grandkids, and I am making my grandson, who will be 8 soon, a sweater. And instead of buying, you know, using expensive yarn or good quality yarn for him, he's a boy, and it wouldn't make sense, I am using this acrylic yarn, 100% acrylic, and I'll tell you about this yarn later, but I came upon it by accident, but it is a Yarn Bee Soft Secret, and this, the color is denim. And I'm going to stripe his as well. There's the denim. And here's the other stripe, which is a really light gray. And it surprised me. It's very, very, very soft. Very soft. Mm-hmm. And I'm crocheting this on a 5mm hook. And this is the back of it. I'm going to hold it back here. I think it shows better when I hold it back. And it may be due to my lighting. I don't know. But I'm just beginning the next colorway. And one of the things I'm really proud of when I looked at this is how straight the ribbon is, ribbing this part down here. I really have improved in my stitch work, I think, greatly. So, this is it. So we'll see how this goes. And I figured that if I could do a small person sweater, then I could eventually learn to do a big person sweater. So that's my rationale. And before I go investing in a sweater for my husband or for myself, the yarn, and not know what the heck I'm doing. So it's actually for his birthday. I'm crocheting it, which it won't be finished by his birthday. His birthday's next week. I aim to have it finished by the end of the month. So this is one in my priority. And I keep this one in my first ever project bag that I got from Kim, the Crafty Nomad, who is also a wonderful podcaster and knitter and crocheter out in California. And she has an Etsy shop, and I'll put all that info in my show notes. But it's huge. I love it, love it, love it. And very well made. Very well made, Kim. So that, what else do I have? Oh, and my third project that I have going. Now, I have been working on this a very long time. Long. My favorite thing to do is knit with lace weight yarn. See how thin that is? And I love making wraps and shawls, you'll see. But I'm already slow, and working with thin yarn to me is a very meditative, prayerful kind of process, and I think that's why I like it. I'm already slow, but not only am I being slow, but it puts me in a headspace, emotional space that feels so calming, so connected to God, and I love that. So this is, and the pattern is called Izumi, I-Z-U-M-I, and it is by Bernadette Ambergeen, and she is also, has an Etsy shop, and makes beautiful patterns for lace weight wraps. But I think there's well over 100 rows to finishing this wrap, and I think I'm nearing halfway done. So I let it sit for a long time because I had so much other things going on. And see, these are my project bags. Isn't that sad? I keep it in a Ziploc bag. But the yarn that I'm using is a Malabrigo yarn, which is called Silpaca, and it's 70% alpaca wool and 30% silk. And I really, really, really love it. Really love it. See how thin that is? You see it? I think the color shows up exactly like it is. And so that's what I'm working on. I'm going to show you some of my finished objects. Not necessarily recently finished, but just so you can get an idea of what I've been doing and how I've been doing it. This is another lace weight shawl. This is my first lace weight shawl or wrap. And it is also a pattern, free pattern, I think, on Ravelry. And for those who don't know, Ravelry is like a social board or site for all things yarn. For all things yarn. And so a lot of designers will put patterns up, some free, some paid. And anyway, this is a pattern that I got off of Ravelry, and it is called, the pattern is called Feathers and Fans, I think. And it is by, yes, Feathers and Fans. It is by A. Westbrook. The initial A, and her name, last name is Westbrook. And this is made with a yarn. I think I have one other skein left. By Juniper Farms, and I can't think of what line it is, but it is, like I said, a lace weight yarn, and it's 50% wool and 50% silk. And this is actually a gift that I need to get to the person. And this is also the first time I blocked a piece. And I don't know why I'm so intimidated by blocking. I hear some yarn heads talk about how they hate to weave in ends of yarn. I love doing that, but blocking is what I am somewhat, I don't know why I have this block against blocking, but it's something that takes me, I don't know, I have to get into a different headspace to do it. I'm intimidated by it. And this is a cowl infinity scarf that I made for someone. I need to get it to her. And it is 100% wool. And I'm putting it on for you, even though it's not mine. It's, hi Danya, this is one of yours that I made. So, I think I can even triple it and not choke. Oh yeah, ooh, ooh, that's gonna be good for those Chicago winters you have. So, this yarn is, and I don't have any more of that. I used just enough. I had just enough to finish this, and got it at my local yarn shop, which I like doing, buying at my local yarn shops. And I think this is called, the yarn is called Viking of Norway, maybe? Viking of Norway, and it's Odin yarn. Yep. I don't know that they still make it, but or if they're still in business. But I love it. I love the color change with it. Color block. But it has to be hand washed or delicate washed and laid flat to dry. And I thought the person I'm making this for is a young mother and or younger mother, I guess I should say. And I thought, now she is going to need something that's kind of rugged, wash and go. So I made this infinity scarf. I haven't, these are the ends. That's the end. I have to weave that in. And so I made one with Lion Brand homespun yarn. And this is kind of a tough yarn. Oh, I don't know about wrapping it three times, but definitely twice. And it's wash and dry in the machine. So I made her this one. And then this one I made a while ago too, but I haven't blocked it and I haven't woven in the ends. But it love this. Look at that drape. Look at that drape, how it moves. Ooh. Love it. I may keep this, Alicia. Hi. And the yarn I used is Cascade yarn, Ultra Pima. And it, talk about smooth. Oh my gosh, for cotton yarn, it's 100% cotton. It was smooth, smooth as butter to use on my hooks, especially with my favorite hooks, which are the Amour, Clover Amour hooks. Oh, it was a dream. It was a dream. And I still need to block it, but I don't know. Looking at it now, maybe I don't. Because it drapes really well. But I'm going to go ahead and block it and get it to her. It was actually a lightweight shawl I was making for the summer. So, I didn't say which summer though, Alicia. So, the last items that I have, and I still have at least 10 balls of this yarn left. I don't know why I bought so much. I got it at a big box store, Joann's. Maybe it was on sale. I don't know what I was thinking. Why would I buy so much of this yarn? Anyway, I'm making scarves. I made scarves with it. And I don't know this pattern, but I'm sure I got it off of Ravelry, and I apologize to the designer for not knowing, keeping the pattern. But it's 100% cotton, made out of Premier yarns called Secret Garden. I made this scarf. This one, which another Ravelry pattern. And it's called, I think I got the name of this one. Let me check. Nancy's Wave Scarf is the name. Is the name of it. And it's also on my project page on my Ravelry. Look at that. Look. I kind of like it. I mean, I do love it. I do actually love it. But I don't know why I bought so many skeins of this yarn. And this one is called Windowpanes, I believe. Yep, Windowpanes by Adrienne LASH. Yep, Adrienne LASH or Leash. Also a Ravelry pattern. I apologize for that interruption. So, so that is off the items that have been off the hooks, and these are also gifts that I need to get to the people I made them for. The next thing I'm going to share with you is I'm going to tell you about my Kuroda University School of Art and what that is all about. When I started quilting, I started buying, you know, reference books and visual art books, and I was in this whole new venture, and I wanted to learn as much as I could and absorb much as I could, because I felt like, it was somehow late in life, and I just needed to get as much info as I could for the time that I had. So I was buying these books like crazy. But what I found is I was actually just collecting and not using them to their fullest potential. So I decided to work through the books to determine how much value they have to my art making and now to my craft of crochet. So I decided to actually work through them. If I decide that this is not something that I think I will ever use, or I can't see myself using even in the distant future, then I'm going to release it. I'm letting it go, you know. Just letting it go. So one of the first books that I'm doing, and I'm kind of setting it up where I try to work through different days, just like you have a Tuesday, Thursday class. You may have a Monday, Wednesday class when you're in college. I try to set it up like that. It doesn't always work. I am adjusting to this home studio and what that means when I have my family here with me, around me. It is an adjustment. So sometimes it doesn't always work as the way that I see it in my head or the way I planned it. But the books that I'm working through, the first one is Creative Strength Training by Jane Dunawall. And it's for artists in general, all artists, not just textile artists or crafters even. It's prompts and exercises and personal stories for encouraging your own artistic genius to help you find your own voice as a crafter and artist. And I highly recommend anything by Jane Dunawall. She is mainly a textile artist, and so her previous books tend to be around textile arts. But if you're in that, have an interest in that, I would definitely say start with her books. The second book is by Ruth B. McDowell, and it's called Piecing, Expanding the Basics. I mostly do my quilt work, my textile work, is mostly large pieces seamed together or either whole cloth. This book, Ruth McDowell is known for her very complicated seams and seaming. If you kind of look at that, to be able to sew these little pieces that are, you know, curved and L-shaped and together and put it all together to create an image, it's pretty, very sophisticated. So I'm going to try it and work through this. There's another one of her quilts. Again, if you can imagine actually seaming these little pieces, there are some methods called fusing, which you can create just this complicated image. But I want to work through it to see if piecing really is something that I would be interested in at some point. Another book is Mixed Media Portraits with Pam Carricker. And this is probably the first, I have an interest in drawing faces, and they transfer, that transfers to my textile work. But this is probably the first book that really made drawing faces accessible to me. I get something from every book that I read, but this is the one that I can really hang with and follow through and kind of understand what I'm doing. And I love Pam's style also of writing, of creating faces, because those are the kind of dreamy quality that she has, is also kind of what I see in my my own quilts. So hers look sometimes look like statues, even statues, you know, carvings to me. But that's a great book if you're interested in drawing portraits or faces. And then one of the things I do, and I've learned to do, is to keep a sketchbook. It's real useful for on many levels for me. Sometimes when I have that downtime and I can't really do anything, I try to at least capture ideas in a sketchbook. I don't keep it every day. It's advised you know, that you do, you work in your sketchbook daily. I don't do that. Probably don't even do it weekly. But when I do do it, I tend to do it daily for that period of time. This is my current sketchbook. I have many, actually, that I dabble in, but this is the current one that I work through. And is, you know, it has, I paint in it. These pages are great. This is a Strathmore brand journal for mixed media. But I paint in it, throw paint around, sketch in it, collage in it. But I practice stuff in it. This was me sketching out of ideas that later did become a small quilt that I did. And, you know, one of the great things about this, that if I mess up, I can paint over it. I mean, the pages are really that good. So when I'm doing that, one of the other things I use to kind of, you know, sometimes I don't consistently work through this, but sometimes I will refer to it. It is by Lynn Perella, and it's Artist Journal and Sketchbooks. And it's not so much as do this, you know, a how-to book, but it's more, it gives you ideas more than anything, and then it'll show you, it'll have a what something is and then how it looks coordinating over here. I think that's pretty much done throughout the book. This is a kind of an instructional page, as much instruction as you get, but it's more an exploration of ideas, I think, and so that's why I like this book. It leaves the reader or the participant room enough to step in and do their own thing. So the last book I'm going to share with you is called Crochet Skill Building Workshop by Dora Orenstein. And this is sort of like a ground up workbook for, it starts with the yarn and the tools that you're using. Shows you how different yarns take different stitch patterns and how they look. And I'm really enjoying it. And I'm still in the beginning of the book. One of the things that blew me away is that Angora wool comes from Angora rabbits and not Angora goats. I always thought they came from the goat or sheep, and I don't know, but Angora. But for some reason, I never connected rabbits with producing fur for yarn. So that was a mind-blowing little thing that I learned. And of course, I had to YouTube Angora goats and see the whole process and see what they look like. Lots of hair on Angora goats. So that is my Kuroda University School of Art. And like I said, I won't, each episode, I may not even cover any of it. I may cover little pieces of it. We'll see. We'll just see. I'm not really sure. So I'm going to go ahead and move on my yarn acquisitions for the month, and then we'll close out with where I can be found on social media. Okay, just give me 1 minute. Okay, this is the part where I show my yarn acquisitions, and or stash enhancements, or stash acquisitions, or. Yeah, my new yarn for the month of August. And I try to buy at least a skein a month. One skein a month. Yeah. This I bought. I have a friend. Tell you this. I had a friend. I was going to surprise her with a beautiful wrap. And was nearly finished. And I was just kind of talking generally about crochet and wraps and the things she wears. Well, in that course of the conversation, I learned that she's allergic to wool. Now, I was making one of those very thin lace yarn wraps and for her, and I thought, you gotta be kidding me. No, I've known her for over 30 years and never knew she was allergic to wool. But she is. Anyway, so I had to go out and buy, I still wanted to make her something, so I went out and bought an acrylic yarn, and I went to, this is Loops and Threads, so I went to Michael's, I think that's a Michael's brand, and I bought this yarn. Can you see it? To make, I think I'm going to make her an infinity scarf, I think that's what I'm going. So I got about 4 skeins of that. And then this is my yarn box, which, and yarn box is a subscription box that you can get every month. I think this is my last, this is August, and I think my last month, I think I'm going to try another yarn subscription. This is also the first yarn subscription I've had. But it's like my birthday every month that it comes, so I love it. But these are the ones that were in August's box. And I have 2 of these and 2 of these, so I got 4 skeins. And the yarn is something I've not even seen in magazines advertised. It is Mitu, M-I-T-U, and it is 50% alpaca and 50% all, U-L-L. I think that, I know that's some kind of wool, but I don't know what kind of wool. Maybe sheep wool, I guess, and the other is alpaca wool. But it's half and half, and this is, it comes out of Norway. And it's pretty soft, compared to the other one, which is also, that I made the cow in, its wool also comes from Norway. And, but yeah, it's okay. It's pretty cool. So I'm actually gonna, and in the yarn box, there's patterns that come, suggested patterns, one for knitting, one for crochet. And I think I'm actually gonna make the, it was a cow scarf, the crochet one, with these 2 colors. So it was that. And then the last acquisition I came across, totally by accident. Yep. I responded to a ad on Craigslist, saw that somebody was selling their blocking boards. For those who don't know, blocking boards are these mats, rubber mats, that you pin your crochet down into to dry while it's wet, and that's called blocking. But anyway, I responded to the blocking boards, and went to pick them up, and the woman also had bags of yarn she showed me, and for little or nothing, I have bags of yarn that I never would have had. This is what I'm making my grandson's sweater out of, one of the yarns that came in this stash. But this is just one bag of soft secret yarn, Bee soft secret, and I think there were at least 10 bags, 10 or 12 bags that were this full. Some partially used yarns, whole skeins of yarn. So I really did. I could show you all the bags that I got, different colors. But I was just like really amazed. She said she would no longer be using these type of yarns anymore. So I was like, she almost insisted I take them, and of course she didn't have to twist my arm that much. But I really did like them, and we'll be doing more. Like I said, my grandkids have an interest in learning to crochet and knit. We've had maybe 1 or 2 lessons. Patience is what challenges them. So we'll see. But this is great teaching yarn. So that's my yarn enhancements. Now, where I can be found on social media. I have mentioned Ravelry a couple of times, and I'm there. under Karoda, K-A-R-O-D-A, 2, the number 2. And I can also be found on Facebook. I have a studio page under Studio Karoda. And then I have a blog, which I have been blogging for over 10 years. It used to be called Chitlin Circuit, which was also the name of my studio that I had in an arts and entertainment venue for 5 years here in Louisville. And I changed it about a year and a half ago to Studio Karoda at blogspot.com. So I can be found there. My blog, where else can I be found? Oh, I just recently joined Instagram some months ago. And I try to mainly keep it yarn related. So I think that's the extent of my social media. And oh, now I'm on YouTube. So that's where I can be found. Again, I will put my show notes, a link to my show notes. If anything that I've referenced interests you, you can go there and find the links. So I thank you for watching. And I'll probably be back in about 10, 15 days with a new podcast. And I'm still trying to come up with a name for my podcast. If you have any suggestions, I'm open. Maybe I'll do some kind of contest. Oh, the other thing I wanted to ask before I close out, for those who are on Ravelry, I don't plan on starting a group for my podcast on Ravelry. I don't know that that's necessary. But tell me what, if you do that, or if you are a member of one of those groups, tell me what you see are the pros and cons of not having a group or having a group on Ravelry for a podcast. I think that's a wrap. See you later.